Let's read Daniel chapter 9. I'm going to read through the whole chapter. I'm going to do that swiftly as I have the last couple of weeks. So I hope you don't mind the speed of the reading, but I think it's going to be helpful for us to get a sense of the whole chapter, having read it at least once, and then we'll dive in and study it. And just a quick warning, when we get to the end of the chapter, unless you are certainly more of a Bible expert than I am, you're going to find a degree of confusion striking you at the end of Daniel chapter 9. Don't worry, I promise we'll take some time and study that at the end of the message this morning. So Daniel chapter 9, verse 1. In the first year of Darius, the son of Ahasuerus, by descent a Mede, who was made king over the realm of the Chaldeans, in the first year of his reign, I, Daniel, perceived in the books the number of years that, according to the word of the Lord to Jeremiah the prophet, must pass before the end of the desolations of Jerusalem, namely 70 years. Then I turned my face to the Lord God, seeking him by prayer and pleas for mercy, with fasting and sackcloth and ashes. I prayed to the Lord my God and made confession, saying, O Lord, the great and awesome God, who keeps covenant and steadfast love with those who love him and keep his commandments, we have sinned and done wrong and acted wickedly and rebelled, turning aside from your commandments and rules. We have not listened to your servants, the prophets, who spoke in your name to our kings, our princes, and our fathers, and to all the people of the land. To you, O Lord, belongs righteousness, but to us, open shame, as at this day, to the men of Judah, to the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and to all Israel, those who are near and those who are far away, in all the lands to which you have driven them, because of the treachery that they have committed against you. To us, O Lord, belongs open shame, to our kings, to our princes, and to our fathers, because we have sinned against you. To the Lord our God belong mercy and forgiveness, for we have rebelled against him and have not obeyed the voice of the Lord our God by walking in his laws, which he set before us by his servants the prophets. All Israel has transgressed your law and turned aside, refusing to obey your voice. And the curse and oath that are written in the law of Moses, the servant of God, have been poured out upon us because we have sinned against him. He has confirmed his words, which he spoke against us and against our rulers who ruled us, by bringing upon us a great calamity. For upon the whole heaven there has not been done anything like what has been done against Jerusalem. As it is written in the law of Moses, all this calamity has come upon us, yet we have not entreated the favor of the Lord our God, turning from our iniquities and gaining insight by your truth. Therefore, the Lord has kept ready the calamity and has brought it upon us. For the Lord our God is righteous in all the works that he has done, and we have not obeyed his voice. And now, O Lord our God, who brought your people out of the land of Egypt with a mighty hand and have made a name for yourself, as at this day we have sinned, we have done wickedly. O Lord, according to all your righteous acts, let your anger and your wrath turn away from your city Jerusalem, your holy hill. Because for our sins and for the iniquities of our fathers, Jerusalem and your people have become a byword among all who are around us. Now, therefore, O our God, listen to the prayer of your servant and to his pleas for mercy. And for your own sake, O Lord, make your face to shine upon your sanctuary, which is desolate. O my God, incline your ear and hear. Open your eyes and see our desolations and the city that is called by your name. For we do not present our pleas before you because of our righteousness, but because of your great mercy. O Lord, hear. O Lord, forgive. O Lord, pay attention and act. Delay not for your own sake, O my God, because your city and your people are called by your name. While I was speaking and praying, confessing my sin and the sin of my people Israel, and presenting my plea before the Lord my God for the holy hill of my God, while I was speaking in prayer, the man Gabriel, whom I had seen in the vision at the first, came to me in swift flight at the time of the evening sacrifice. He made me understand, speaking with me and saying, O Daniel, I have now come to give you insight and understanding. At the beginning of your pleas for mercy, a word went out, and I have come to tell it to you, for you are greatly loved. Therefore, consider the word and understand the vision. 70 weeks are decreed about your people and your holy city to finish the transgression,
to put an end to sin and to atone for iniquity, to bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal both vision and prophet, and to anoint a most holy place. Know therefore and understand that from the going out of the word to restore and build Jerusalem to the coming of an anointed one, a prince, there shall be 7 weeks. Then for 62 weeks it shall be built again with squares and moat, but in a troubled time. And after the 62 weeks an anointed one shall be cut off and shall have nothing. And the people of the prince who is to come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. Its end shall come with a flood. And to the end there shall be war. Desolations are decreed, and he shall make a strong covenant with many for 1 week, and for half of the week he shall put an end to sacrifice and offering, and on the wing of abomination shall come one who makes desolate until the decreed end is poured out on the desolator. Amen. At one point, I had an app on my phone called MyFitnessPal. And MyFitnessPal was a great little app. It would count your caloric intake for the day. And what I liked about it was if you exercised, you could plug that in as well. And it would count against your calorie intake. So if you wanted to have a larger lunch or had a birthday party or something, you could jog that evening for a few minutes and the numbers would magically work out so that you could still meet your goal at the end of the day. So exercise sort of counted against calories. It was this great little combination tool that it had. Now, the unfortunate thing is that often we live our life that same way. We live our Christian life like MyFitnessPal. We assume that when we sin, it's bad. It counts against us, so to speak. But, good news, we can try to make up for that by doing some act of godliness or trying harder next week. And so they kind of count against each other so that in the grand scheme of things, we manage it so that we reach our goal and there's sort of a balanced, managed amount of sin and godliness in our life. We do that all the time, don't we? We have a bad week and we're aware of it. Excuse me. We're aware of the negative side. So we'll sort of make up for that. Excuse me. A good week where it can have a kind of a godliness side. We'll make up on godliness what we did in sin. The problem is, sins are not calories. They can't be undone by godliness. Sins are not calories. They can't be undone by godliness. And our life is not intended to be a management of godliness and sin anyway. Our life is intended to be in relationship with God. The goal of the Christian life is not to sort of manage just the right amount of sin and counteracting godliness. The goal is to know and love God, to do all that we are for God. Well, Daniel chapter 9, in all of the difficult aspects of it, ultimately what it presents us with is a call to a type of relationship with the Lord expressed in prayer that doesn't just manage sin and godliness, but calls out to him for mercy and is reconciled to him because of his grace. That's ultimately what this passage does. Thank you. Ultimately, it invites us to not a managed Christianity, but a relationship characterized by desperate confidence in the mercy of God. If I was going to summarize this whole chapter, what does it do for us as a Christian? I would say it this way. This chapter calls us to desperate, confident prayer in the mercy of God. Let our prayers reveal desperate confidence in God's mercy. That's what I think Daniel is saying to us. Let our prayers reveal desperate confidence in the mercy of God. All right, I'm going to break this passage and study of it into two sections, all right? The desperate prayer. Desperate prayer, and then divine response. I trust it's not difficult to see why. The first, Daniel prays this lengthy prayer, and then there's a divine response. Now, obviously, given the length and given the difficulty of some of these sections, there's no way we're going to study every detail, but this prayer would be worth lengthy meditations on your own. Daniel's humility, Daniel's faith, Daniel's description of God and his awareness of Israel's history and the right understanding of God's rightful judgment combined with God's mercy, it would be worth deep personal study. If you've never studied Daniel 9 before in private, let me encourage you to do that. This is a marvelous prayer of the scriptures that could serve us in our own walk with the Lord. Desperate prayer, but let me say a few points about it. First of all, we notice that Daniel's prayer and even the motivation of it is shaped by God's word. Did you notice that at the very beginning? It says that Daniel perceived in the books, that would be the biblical books, the number of years that according to the word of the Lord to Jeremiah the prophet must pass before the end of the desolations of Jerusalem. Remember, Daniel is in exile with God's people. They were sent out of the land because of their sin, and he has suffered through a number of overseeing kingdoms and empires at this point. And he reads Jeremiah, apparently in his private devotional life, he's reading Jeremiah, and he comes across a prediction, a prophecy that this exile is only going to last so long, namely 70 years. And since one of the verses that he probably was thinking of is a Christian magnet verse, it's on a lot of refrigerators, I thought it'd be worth reading so you can see it actually has a broader context than just a pithy little nice saying. Here's one of the verses probably Daniel was thinking of. Jeremiah 29 says this, "For thus says the Lord, when 70 years are completed for Babylon, I will visit you, and I will fulfill to you my promise and bring you back to this place. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans for welfare and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope. Then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will hear you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and I will restore your fortunes and gather you from all the nations and all the places where I have driven you, declares the Lord, and I will bring you back to the place from which I sent you into exile." So you can almost imagine Daniel is just reading those words in his private study of God's word. He comes across that magnet verse that says, "I have a future and a hope for you," that we all quote. And then it says, and also that's connected to the end of the exile in Babylon. So he begins to pray. And he prays with a level of desperation and mourning. It says with sackcloth and ashes, he cries out to the Lord. So it's shaped by God's word. There's also a passage in Leviticus where God makes clear that God's people, even in exile, can call out to him, can cry out to him, and that he will hear them. He will not permanently banish them. So that this exile would not be permanent, will not be final, will not be eternal in that sense. So Daniel begins to pray. There's a few aspects of his prayer that I think it's worth bringing out. First of all, you want to notice the emphasis on the righteousness of God's judgment. Did you notice at the beginning part of the prayer, Daniel explicitly contrasts the sinfulness of God's people and the rightfulness of God's judgment against them? He's summarizing what happens in the Bible if you read 1 and 2 Kings or 1 and 2 Chronicles, and you see this is literally true. That they rebelled repeatedly against God, that they rejected God, they worshiped idols. And so Daniel is saying, look, we're not in exile because God forgot about us for a couple years. We're not in exile because God happened to, oh my goodness, the Babylonians, here they come. No, we're in exile because we rebelled and turned away from God. He uses the word treachery down there in verse 7. We've committed treachery against you. The God who brought us out of Egypt and planted us in this land, we turned away from that God and worshiped idols. And so he is confessing and acknowledging the righteousness of God's judgment. He's also taking personal responsibility as God's people for sin. Very important thing to notice. Notice, to us, he says, belongs open shame, verse 7. To you belongs righteousness, to us open shame because of the treachery we have committed against you. All Israel, verse 11, has transgressed your law and turned aside, refusing to obey your voice. So this prayer is primarily a prayer of repentance. It's a prayer of desperate repentance. He sees God's righteousness in judgment based on the rebellion of God's people. And he recognizes that God has promised them a restoration, But he doesn't assume that restoration is going to come without the repentance of the people. It's a valuable lesson. It's God's promises in the Bible are never meant to minimize things like repentance and obedience and calling out to him in prayer. They're meant to motivate them. So because we have confidence, God will forgive, God will show mercy, God will restore, God will redeem, it is never meant in the scriptures to undermine desperate prayer. It's meant to motivate it. Since God has promised to do these things, and since God always brings forgiveness and repentance in the scriptures, he likes to do that in response to the prayers of his people. We should take that as motivation for this kind of repentant, penitent, confessional prayer that rightly acknowledges sin and the righteousness of God's judgment against sin, and then also emphasizes the character of God's covenant promises. So three categories I would keep in mind as you're reading this prayer. First of all, the righteousness of God's judgment. Daniel emphasizes that. He emphasizes the responsibility of sin. And then he emphasizes hope in God's covenant promises. Did you notice down there, he emphasizes the mercy of God. To you, O Lord, he says, belongs these things. Belongs in verse 9, mercy and forgiveness. It belongs with you, God, to be merciful and to forgive. And you notice the emphasis at the end where he's calling out that God would make your face shine on your sanctuary. Now, this is not Daniel just expressing a wish or a hope. I wish you would, God. He's laying claim on what God has said in the scriptures that for his own namesake, he will forgive and restore his people. That for his own glory, not because of any righteousness on their part, but for his own glory, he will bring forgiveness and redemption to those who have rebelled against him. And so he lays claim on those covenant promises that God has bound himself to his people. And that he has laid on himself the responsibility to restore and forgive them. So he lays claim on those promises and he says, O Lord, verse 16, according to all your righteous acts, let your wrath turn away from Jerusalem. He says, now therefore, O God, listen to the prayer and make your face shine on your sanctuary. Incline your ear, open your eyes, see your desolations, the city, notice, that is called by your name because of your great mercy. You notice the repetitions at the end. Oh, Lord, hear. Oh, Lord, forgive. Oh, Lord, pay attention and act. Delay not for your own sake, oh, my God, because of your city and your people that are called by your name. What's he doing? He's rightfully laying claim to the jealousy of God, giving himself glory by redeeming his own people. He's laying claim to the righteous jealousy of God for his own glory, redeeming his people. He's saying, glorify yourself, God, by redeeming us, by forgiving us. In light of our sins, we could get no credit if you do this. But Lord, that's perfect. That way you'll get all the credit. Now, what does this prayer mean for us? We are not in the same kind of exile that Daniel was in. But this exile is really just reflective of the broader exile from God that every human being endures because of sin. We know that from the beginning of the Bible, when people sin, they are sent out of God's presence, they are broken in their relationship with him, and they cannot approach him because of his holiness and their hatred of him. And so if you're here and you're not a Christian, you're not a believer in Jesus Christ, you need to see in Daniel's prayer the great invitation of the Bible. The great invitation of the Bible is to say to you, repent of your sins and call out to God that he would be merciful to you, that he would forgive you, not because of any righteousness on your own, not because you're going to be more godly next week and get that back to zero. No, because you can't make up for sins with godliness. Only God can forgive and restore and redeem. So if you're not a Christian and you don't know about God, but you're aware of that little internal measurement where you try to make up for bad things with good things, whether you think of yourself as currently at zero or slightly negative or slightly positive, let the Bible break into that way of thinking and learn Daniel's prayer, where he confesses, I have sinned against you. I haven't loved you with all my heart and all my soul as your people. We haven't done that, God. But you are a God full of forgiveness, and you can cry out to God, and he will answer in his forgiveness the way he's going to answer Daniel. For Christians, we need to remember that, no, we don't have this kind of physical exile from an earthly Jerusalem like Daniel did, but we do have sins that in a subjective way lead us away from the Lord. In a subjective way, we can experience a sort of a distance from God, not in his love towards us, but in our love towards him. Our sins can create a kind of an experiential distance. And so the Bible calls even Christians to repent. John says to his readers of his epistle, confess your sins to the one who is faithful and just to forgive you your sins and cleanse you of all unrighteousness. So I think in Daniel's prayer, we can see something that we're supposed to do ongoingly as Christians. Even though we're forgiven in Jesus Christ, it honors what Jesus did when we sin to confess those sins to him, to acknowledge them as sinful in the way that Daniel does here, to not treat sins as mere calories that can be made up for by some godliness, but to treat sins as something that must be brought to God that only God can forgive. So that's why Daniel's language is instructive here for the Christian. Not because we're physically removed from an earthly Jerusalem, but because our sins still lead us away from the Lord. And in repentance and crying out for mercy, we draw near to him again. Helpful quote from a man named Herman Veldkamp. He says, "What distinguishes us, that's the church, from the world is not that we are less wicked, but that by the grace of God, we have learned to see our wickedness for what it is, and that we confess our sins. Where the confession of sin dies out, the church is no longer church. Where the confession of sin dies out, the church is no longer church." If you're a guest, just so that you know, look, members of this church aren't here because they have this perfect record of godliness going back to their birth. That's not why they're members of this church. We don't have a membership requirement that says, please state all godly acts, and if there's been any sin or grievous acts, you can't be a member. No. The peoples of this church are sinners who acknowledged that sin and came to Jesus in repentance and received his forgiveness, just like Daniel's asking for here. We're not better in the ultimate scope of our life. Now, we're trying to grow in godliness, and hopefully God is changing us in that sense. But looking back over our life, we're not better. Plenty of wickedness done before conversion, and plenty of sins continue to be done even after conversion to Jesus. The difference is a Christian acknowledges and presents those before the Lord and lays claim on the mercy offered by God. I think repentance is a lost discipline in the Christian church. I think we're afraid of repentance because we don't want to lose a fragile sense of assurance of our salvation. Assurance without repentance is fragile. Assurance without repentance is fragile. Because you're always wondering whether some sin eventually will break in that will cause you to just doubt your whole salvation. But if your practice is to repent, is to name sins, that was selfish. I dishonored you by saying that to my child. I dishonored you by neglecting this call of God in my life. I dishonored you by that look or that glance or that word or that craving. I dishonored you in that way. Lord, forgive. Then the assurance of God's character and his covenant, especially the covenant that comes in Jesus of absolute forgiveness, comes in to remind us, look, the worst sin is forgiven because God has created a new covenant in Jesus that forgives every sin and declares no condemnation for those that are in Christ Jesus. So never looking at sin actually undermines assurance because there's this nagging doubt that there might be something back there that God wouldn't forgive. Acknowledging and looking and confessing sin and then taking it to the covenant-keeping God of Jesus then ushers in the assurance God knows them all and he declares them forgiven in Jesus Christ. Repentance is a celebration of God's mercy when it turns to the covenant-keeping God that has given us forgiveness in Jesus Christ. Desperate prayer is needed desperately in the church. Prayers of confession needed desperately in the church that turn their gaze towards God and towards his covenant promises, which in the New Testament are even more glorious and more magnificent than the promises Daniel is referencing in the Old Testament. Desperate prayer. Then divine response. Divine response. This is where we get into some of the confusing parts of the passage. If we could only read the first half, I think we'd feel very comfortable. The second half, it gets a little more difficult. I read one commentator this week that said, if you ever hear somebody say, they know, this is a paraphrase, but they know exactly what's going on in the second half of Daniel chapter 9, don't listen to them anymore. I found that to be true this week. There are some confusing aspects here. However, I think there are things that are clear that we can benefit greatly from. They are clear. First, let me address this introductory paragraph beginning in verse 20 when it says that while Daniel was speaking and praying, confessing his sin, sin of his people, the angel, we're told elsewhere, the angel Gabriel, appears to be an angel, who had seen in his vision, comes in swift flight, and he makes this announcement that he has come to give Daniel insight and understanding, and he says, I've come because you are greatly loved. So before we get into the content, the message, I just want to make a quick point about the mode and the motive of this response. This response is swift, and it's motivated by God's love for Daniel. That there's something deeply meaningful we can take out of those descriptions. Daniel is desperately praying. He is crying out to the Lord. And apparently, the Lord immediately responds. He immediately responds. Now, the response is not going to be just perfectly neat and clean and Daniel gets to, you know, eat ice cream the rest of his life. It's not that the response is just full of physical well-being in all senses, but the response is immediate and it's motivated by God's love for Daniel. And I think that's a motivation for us. That paragraph is a motivation for us in our prayers. That desperate prayer leads to God's response to those that he loves. And as Christians, we know that he loves us in Christ, so that when you're crying out to God, this kind of immediacy, that this angel is sent to give insight. Now, we're not maybe going to see an angel every time we pray, but this same disposition in God's heart is there. We see elsewhere in Scripture, as soon as he hears it, he answers you, he is listening for the sound of your cry. This should motivate our prayer, that God is not in need of being woken up for our prayer time. He's not in need of a microphone for us to shout up to heaven. God is ready to hear, to respond because of his love for us. That should motivate our prayers, and even prayers of confession. Don't we think of confession as sort of working our way towards God? That we confess enough, and then gradually we're sort of closer and closer, the more we are aware of what we've done wrong, and then gradually God kind of turns and says, okay, I think we've sufficiently covered that ground, and now I'll relate to you. But this passage says, as soon as Daniel begins speaking, God responds because of his love for him. So before Daniel even goes through all of his listing of his sins, God, out of love for Daniel, responds to him. Now we've looked at the New Testament. This is a very, very valuable lesson, and the New Testament makes it even more clear. We don't confess, as Christians, we don't confess and repent to get into God's presence. We confess in the presence of the God who loves us. Isn't that an important difference? We don't confess to get into God's presence. We repent and confess in the presence of the God who loves us. Otherwise, confession and repentance can be a sort of a substitute savior. This happened to me when I was a teenager. I just had this idea that I couldn't read my Bible until I had repented of whatever I'd done, the day before, the week before. It felt wrong. So I opened my Bible to read it. No, I've got to do more considering. What have I done wrong? And at one point, God convicted me that my conviction was inaccurate. And it was very difficult. I would open my Bible, and it just felt wrong. It's like, this is just wrong. I can't read. And it just struck me all of a sudden. It was like the Lord just bringing to me, you're talking about reading the Bible. Why would that be wrong? I don't know. It just feels like I'm not worthy of it. I could almost imagine God saying something like, well, then read the passage about how that's true. You're not worthy of it, but God loves you in Jesus. Confession and repentance, if you're like me and you want to kind of work your way to God in confession, change the image. God loves you. And in Jesus, he's brought you into his presence. Should you confess and repent? Yes. But it's the confession and repentance of a child tearfully sitting on his father's lap and declaring, I've done wrong. Not the person knocking at the door and hoping if you confess the right way, God will open it. And this swiftness of response just depicts in a narrative way that truth because of Daniel's love. The moment he opens his mouth, God responds. Why? Because you're greatly loved, Daniel. Interesting to note that Daniel is pleading for God's people, and we should be like Daniel and respond in that way. But in an even greater sense, we have someone who is pleading for us, who's even more righteous than Daniel was, who is the beloved Son of God. And so when we start crying out in prayer, that intercessor has already been representing us. And God's reaction to us is based on him. Certainly even swifter than a response based on God's love for Daniel. Mode and motive. It's swift. It's motivated by love. Now let's get to this message. The 70 weeks. A couple of thoughts I thought would be helpful to hit as we hit this passage, just about reading your Bible. All right, so just about reading your Bible. Just a couple kind of principles of studying your Bible that are very, very important. First of all, don't call the clear passages obscure. All right, this happens all the time in popular culture. There's a passage, say, in the New Testament about a particular way of life or type of sin, and it's abundantly clear. There's no passages that contradict it. There's no other scriptures that modify it. It's just direct and clear. It's repeated in other passages of scripture. And people will say, well, I think it's obscure. And it's not obscure. It's very clear. There's no contradiction elsewhere. It's not vague in the way it's written. Don't call clear passages obscure. Very dangerous. Don't assume just because somebody says online or in a blog, well, this passage is very disputed. That means it's, of course it's disputed. It's a sinful world. God is disputed. The Bible is disputed. Of course it's disputed. That's no question. Is it clear? So don't call clear passages obscure, but also don't call obscure passages clear. Don't call obscure passages clear. Daniel, the end of Daniel chapter 9 is a difficult passage of scripture. Now, I think it has benefit for us, and I'll try to hit some of those points right now. But it is difficult. I mean, even one commentator I read this week, very trustworthy, very knowledgeable, he said, when I first prepared to teach on Daniel, my topic of my lecture was 70 weeks and 20 questions. They're reluctant to say exactly what this means and the timing. So let me just warn you. It is unwise to look at a passage like this and base your whole theology out of it. Base your whole definition of maybe the scope of history or the end times. Unwise. There's other passages about the end times that are much more direct and explicit and that could help us understand this. Don't call clear passages obscure, and don't call the obscure passages clear. Third point, clear passages should guide us in the obscure passages. What we know definitively should help us in passages that are challenging, difficult, 70 weeks and half a week and anointed one. There's passages that are much more explicit. They can help us in passages like this. All right, just a few points about reading the Bible. Okay, a couple of things in this answer that I think are reasonably clear and that motivate us to pray desperately for God's mercy the way Daniel does. To pray desperately, but confidently. Because essentially, this answer, in all that it says, is an answer that basically says yes. In all that it says, The overarching answer of all this phrases and everything is, Daniel says, God, please be merciful to your sinful people. And the summary of it all is, God says, I will be. I will be. Okay, a number of things. I'm going to just list five of them that we could glean without getting too deep into some of the disputed sections here. Five things that I think we can get out of this answer. First of all, the goal is glorious. The goal is, look at this, look at verse 24. Remember, Daniel's praying, Lord, please be merciful to your people. Here's the answer. 70 weeks, that's literally 70 sevens, are decreed about your people and your holy city. And listen to this goal, and hear the merciful answer of God. What's going to happen when this confusing time, 70 weeks, takes place? What's going to happen as a result of this time? Here's the goal. To finish transgression, to put an end to sin, and to atone for iniquity. And then it keeps going. To bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal, that doesn't mean to hide, most likely that means to confirm or fulfill, to seal both vision and prophet, and to anoint a most holy place. The goal is glorious. Before anything else happens, we don't know, 70 weeks, is that 70 times 7 years? Is that a metaphorical phrase? That's where the confusion comes in. But we know, whenever that time is, whenever it ends, here's what's going to happen. Transgression's going to be finished. Sin's going to be put an end to. There's going to be an atonement for iniquity. There's going to be everlasting righteousness. The vision and the prophet are going to be sealed and confirmed, and a most holy place is going to be anointed. Now that goal is magnificent and should comfort us. Even if we can't say exactly how or when or what's the timing here. Look, the end of it is magnificent. And we read in the New Testament that's exactly what God promises Christ brings into fulfillment. A time when there will be no more sin or sorrow, when the iniquities of God's people will be atoned for, when everlasting righteousness will be the character of God's dwelling with people, and that the prophecies about God's purposes will be fulfilled, and there will indeed be a most holy place anointed where God dwells with people. The goal is magnificent. So unfortunately, when we get into this, you kind of skip over that ultimate goal and you go right to, well, what in the world? Building and sick moats and square. But the goal is incredible. And the essential answer is, I will, Daniel. I will. Be merciful, God. I will. Beyond your wildest dreams, I will. Everlasting righteousness. The trouble of sin that have been with your people for such a long time, it's going to be done forever. The payment for sin that you've had to pay for with goat after goat after goat in the temple, it's going to be done forever. Iniquities are going to be atoned for. All of God's purposes and promises are going to be fulfilled, Daniel. Yes, is the overwhelming answer. Yes, now that's clear. That's clear. Even if we don't know exactly how it works out, like it says in the passage, that's clear in this passage. Yes, Daniel. The goal is glorious. Second thing we can see that's clear. There's going to be a lengthy endurance until that goal is reached. A lengthy endurance. Most likely, the phrase 77s is a metaphorical phrase that describes a lengthy period of time, which would have been a surprise for Daniel. Because Daniel was assuming, look, this 70 years is going to just bring a final culmination. God's going to restore his people to the land. But God says, well, there's more endurance still to be had, Daniel. And we've seen this in the rest of Daniel, that this is the prediction, that even after the Babylonians and the Persians, there's going to come more empires and more kingdoms and more kings. So this is in keeping with everything else Daniel says. There's going to be a lengthy endurance. That's clear as well. One commentator, Ian Duguid, says, in general terms, we can say that Daniel's prayer received both an immediate and an ultimate answer. God's immediate answer to Daniel's prayer was to raise up Cyrus, the Persian king, who issued the decree that allowed the Jews to return to their home. This decree was issued in 538 BC, within a year of the fall of the Babylonian Empire, so that it occurred almost immediately after Daniel's prayer in the first year of Darius. So a number of Jews went home. God restored, and they rebuilt under Ezra and Nehemiah. Daniel prayed, and in response, God moved the heart of the greatest ruler of the day to bring about a return of his people to their land, where they could once again rebuild the ruined temple. But the message that the angel Gabriel brought to Daniel was that this immediate answer to Daniel's prayer was merely a partial fulfillment of God's plans. The problem of Israel's rebellious heart that caused the exile in the first place would not be dealt with merely by bringing them back to the land. That would require a much more awesome demonstration of God's greatness and grace, which would be accomplished in the coming of Jesus. Jesus is the one in whom God would deal once and for all with our sin, and thus fulfill his original purposes for the people. In Jesus, there is an unparalleled demonstration of God's greatness. Second quote, I know this is two longer quotes, but they're helpful, I think, to understand this. The authors of the New Testament interpreted Daniel as having been and going to be fulfilled. Who Jesus is and what he accomplished fulfill much that Daniel prophesied, and the New Testament authors promise that some aspects of Daniel's prophecy, such as the consummation of all things in Daniel 9:24 and the resurrection of the dead in Daniel 12:2, await fulfillment at Christ's return. So we know, based on this passage, that there's going to be a lengthy endurance. God's answer is going to come partially when the Jews are returned to their land, but there's more to see. There's more to do. And this answer of mercy is also helping Daniel prepare for that endurance. 70 sevens, Daniel. 70 times seven. In Daniel's mind, the way they thought about the number seven, that there was a sense of, wow, that's a long time. That's a lot of waiting. It is going to be. The end is going to be glorious, but it is going to be some waiting. That seems clear in this passage. Now, a couple of words just briefly about the timing, and this is where I'm not going to come down and stamp and say, I know exactly what this timing means, okay? So if you come up after me and say, I'm not sure that the first seven is exactly right, I'm saying, you might be right. You might be right. That's possible. I mean, guys way smarter than me aren't exactly sure, but if you wanted my guess on the timing as it's referenced here, here's what I would say. The first 7 weeks that you notice there, it says that from the going out of the word to restore Jerusalem to the coming of an anointed one, a prince, there shall be 7 weeks. I think that's a reference to when Jerusalem was initially rebuilt after the exile. It was initially rebuilt. Then there's 62 weeks. You don't have to do crazy math, just 62 plus 7, 69. So then there's 62 weeks when the anointed, basically, it's going to be rebuilt, it says, but in a troubled time. Well, I think probably that refers to the time between when it was rebuilt and the coming of Jesus, because it was indeed a troubled time. Jerusalem was rebuilt, but then other empires came in, and there was Antiochus, like we talked about last week, the Greek ruler who crushed God's people, and then the Romans came in. That would seem to describe when Jerusalem is rebuilt, but there's a troubled time. So I think that's the 62 weeks. So we've got 7 weeks and 62 weeks. Then it says after the 62 weeks, so this is in the 70th week, in the 70th week, and I'm using week metaphorically, in the 70th seven, an anointed one shall be cut off and shall have nothing. More of that in a minute. But something's going to happen to an anointed one, a Messiah. He's going to be cut off and she'll have nothing after 69 weeks have taken place. And I think that's a reference to the coming of Jesus and the cutting off of Jesus. That seems relatively clear, actually. And then it gets back into the confusion again. Then the prince who is to come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. Its end shall come with the flood. Desolations are decreed. He shall make a strong covenant with many for 1 week. He shall, for half of the week, put an end to sacrifice and offering. And then there's going to be abominations. One who makes desolate and the decreed end is poured out on the desolator. I think that that's referring to this final climactic season of time, when there's going to be persecutions and desolations. Part of the reason I think that is that Jesus says to his followers, when you see the abomination of desolation that Daniel talks about, that's the time to flee. So it would seem like to me, based on that passage and what Paul says to the Thessalonian church, that this desolation and abomination and destroying the people, all that stuff at the end there, is talking about the end of time that in some sense is present now, but it culminates before Jesus returns, when there's going to be great persecution. That's what we see in the rest of Daniel. So if you want my sense, I think that's the timing. Jerusalem happens, There's a lengthy time of trouble where Jerusalem is rebuilt. Then the seventh final week begins. An anointed one is cut off. And then there's great persecution and abomination. And then finally that one is judged. That one seems to line up to me with the timing that we actually see in history and what the New Testament talks about. In any case, what's clear for Daniel and what is reiterated in the New Testament is the endurance to see God's goal fulfilled is going to be lengthy, Daniel. The answer is yes, but it's a long yes. Be prepared for it. Okay, two things that are clear so far. A glorious goal, a lengthy endurance, and then three quickly, finally, an afflicted anointed one. After 69 weeks, it says, an anointed one shall be cut off and shall have nothing. Now, I think it's possible to read that without having some sense of what happened to Jesus Christ, especially when you consider that the ultimate result of this is going to be an atonement for iniquity. That's what happens after a lengthy period of waiting. After the 69 weeks, an anointed one is cut off. Well, we know an anointed one who was cut off. And we know, maybe in a way that Daniel didn't, that all of this mercy that Daniel was praying for and that God was then promising was based on that one little phrase, an anointed one shall be cut off and shall have nothing. So we know when we pray for mercy, not just that God's merciful out of some benevolent type of character that has no outworking in history, but that that mercy was displayed finally when Jesus Christ took on the sins of his people that Daniel enumerates here and received the punishment for every single one of those on the cross, and that when he rose from the dead, there was hope that all of these promises would be finally fulfilled. An end of transgression, a coming of an anointed place where God dwell with men, where iniquities are atoned for. So whatever else is confusing, and was it actually 7 weeks or how long? I don't know. What we do know is that this anointed one that was going to be cut off at the end of that time was going to be the one that was going to usher in the yes to God's mercy that answers Daniel's prayer. And he's the same one that gives the yes to our prayers for mercy as well. So that when we confess our sins like Daniel does, God is faithful and just because the anointed one was cut off and had nothing. We also see that abominations and desolations are decreed for God's people. Verse 26, 27, 28, it emphasizes this idea that there's going to be people on earth and maybe a final ultimate one. Paul describes him, I think, as the lawless one who is going to deceive many. He's going to try to eradicate worship on the earth. And so this passage, and really this is true throughout Daniel, so this is just confirming what other chapters have said. Christians need to be prepared for deceivers and maybe a great deceiver on earth that will attempt to destroy the worship of God physically and through seduction to lead people astray. And so, yes, the goal is glorious, but it's going to take a long endurance to get there. A long endurance in the face of people who create desolations and abominations and seek to destroy the worship of God. And yes, Christians, Daniel, the book in general, tells us be prepared for that, but trust ultimately that the King of Kings, who amazingly is also the anointed one who is cut off, will ultimately prevail because, final thing to say that is clear, the desolator will be destroyed. Last phrase in the passage, the decreed end will be poured out on the desolator. I think five things about this answer in the midst of a lot of confusion are very clear. There's a glorious goal. There's going to be a lengthy endurance to get there. There is going to be an afflicted one that's going to be cut off, an anointed one. There's going to be abominations and desolations for God's people. But then finally, there's going to be a judgment on that one who seeks to seduce and deceive them. So that the resounding answer of all of those things, when you put them together, is this: God, be merciful.
We are sinful, but Lord, show us mercy. The resounding answer is, yes, I will. More than you can imagine. More than you could dream of. And that same answer comes to you when you pray for the restoration of God's people and for repentance in your own life. Because of Jesus Christ, the same answer comes to you. Yes, I will be merciful to you. One day, your sins will be no more, and there will be an everlasting righteousness. Your sins are atoned for, and one day your persecutors will be judged. Yes, is God's answer to Daniel. And it came swift, and it came motivated by the love of God. So Daniel chapter 9, for whatever the parts are that are confusing, should be an overwhelming comfort to God's people. When you pray and cry out to our God that he be merciful, because yes, indeed, like Daniel says, the people of God continue to sin and struggle. As the hymn says, we are prone to wander. We can still say, because of Daniel 9 and its confirmation in the New Testament, it is well with my soul. My sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought, my sin, not in part, but the whole, is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, oh, my soul. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we want to exult in your mercy. Yes. We exult in it. Lord, we pray desperately, Lord, that wherever there are sins that we have committed, even this week, even this morning, we pray for your forgiveness, Lord. We pray that you would have mercy on us, Lord. We invite your forgiveness. We repent of those sins. But Lord, we also declare that based on your word's own promise, that you are faithful and just to forgive us our sins, to cleanse us of all unrighteousness, and to promise us hope and glory with you forever. So we receive the comfort that this is intended to give us. Lord, make us a repenting church. And make us a confident church in your mercy. Yes. Let's just take a moment and do this personally. If there's an area of your life that you felt convicted of recently or historically, let's take a minute and just do what Daniel did. Let's just acknowledge that before the Lord. Enjoy the promise of God's response. Romans 8:1 says, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. So for that sin, because of Jesus Christ, there is no condemnation. Lord Jesus, thank you for bearing our sins on the cross. Thank you for bearing our sins. We receive your forgiveness. We receive it. Lord, I pray for those who have felt lingering guilt and lingering conviction, Lord, that you would rush in with the assurance of your love right now. Lord, those that look back on grievous failures in the past and have just felt nagging conviction for years, Lord, would you rush in swiftly with the assurance of your love because of Jesus? Comfort them right now, I pray, in Jesus' name. Assure them of your love. Assure them of your awareness of their sin and your forgiveness of their sin. Assure them, Lord. In Jesus' name.